Hannah Lee. For some of my hockey superstars that may be listening, my name would be Miss Lee, and you would know me from the hockey pitch at Ballard. So today I'm going to give you a presentation all about elite sport. Now, for some of you, you may be thinking that elite sport hasn't really got anything to do with you, or you're not very interested in sport. But have a listen, because I really believe that you can learn a lot from elite sports people, whether that be through sport or your daily life. Everything that you do, you can learn. So have a listen, and I hope you enjoy it.
Now, to do this, we'll be looking and exploring a number of different factors regarding elite sport and elite athletes. We're going to be looking at what elite sport is, what exactly it takes for an athlete to become elite in their sport, the challenges that athletes face in their journey to becoming elite, the role that sports psychology can play in helping an athlete, how a person can go about achieving an elite mindset, and most of all, a key takeaway is going to be about considering what every individual can learn from elite athletes and apply in general day-to-day life. When presented with the question of what is elite sport, some key things may come to mind, such as talent as a driver for competing in the first place, professionals, because elite sport can be a job, performances that are high level to reach such standard, medals, which act as a symbol of success in elite sport. Ultimately, large competitions such as the Olympics and the Commonwealth Games. Sponsorships that can be awarded from brands such as Nike and Adidas. The money, which is received as a prize or a reward for certain achievements. Being the best at a particular discipline. The hard work that's involved throughout the elite level to maintain a standard, or you may consider that the athlete competing in a sport has a natural talent or ability. You may also consider the love for sport and the passion that is involved for an athlete to achieve and strive to be the best. So what actually is elite sport then? Well, there are multiple classifications of what an elite athlete is, but among scientific debates, the term can be generalised as those at the pinnacle of their sport, competing at the highest competitive level, considered to be the best at their discipline. They can be differentiated by the level that they have achieved. Different to an amateur athlete, the elite have a greater prospect for earning money as they become more professional and therefore have more time to train and focus on performance. Elite sport is therefore the overarching term used to describe the highest level of competitive sport involving those at the pinnacle of their performance. When you think of elite sport, you may think of athletes such as Usain Bolt, famous for being the fastest man in the world and his trademark winning Bolt sign, Roger Federer for his achievement in tennis, or Harry Kane as the captain of the English football team. These athletes more often than not become role models, which means people aspire to be like them, maybe because of their ability or their characteristics. Having competed in international youth sport and breaking into professional sport in the last few years, I myself can be considered elite, competing in regular elite sporting competitions. I now play for Mannheimer Hockey Club in Germany, and I'm soon to be approaching my fifth year as part of the club. I'm going to show you around what has been my hockey home for the last years. I say hockey home because when I have been in Germany, it was mainly for the purpose of hockey.
Hi, so I'm going to show you around the hockey club. Over there, what you've just seen, we have a stand. Our main hockey pitch over here where we play all our matches, and that's called the arena. We've got a second hockey pitch over there. So now I'm going to show you around the club. So right here we have the main place where we eat all everything. It's called the Glasshouse. It's a very big sort of restaurant that anyone can really come and eat at.
They do really great match teas for us, and we have a lot of team events there as well. We have guest changing rooms here for teams that are coming to play against us. On the right here, you can see this big building, and we're going to have a look in there, but just to explain, here we have a small indoor field, which is where that we play most of our indoor, but we also have a big indoor field as well, where all the matches are played. So if we have a look in here, we've got also our changing rooms, we've got our gyms, and everything we need. So as you come in here, our official changing rooms are on the right through there, but this is where we play our indoor hockey. So it's a very big field here. These stands come out and make a big stand so that we have very big events, lots of lights, scoreboards and everything. So as we come out through here, we can then connect to the gym. So we always walk through here when we want to go to the gym. So when we've got ourselves ready from training, it's a little bit dark. There we go. We get ready in the change rooms and we walk through here to the gym. And most of the time we warm up in the gym. So we first go to the gym, do our strength and conditioning training, which is once or twice a week. And so that once or twice a week we spend in the gym. There's lots more change rooms here, so when guests come and play against us, they always have room to have that little changing room. So as we come up here to the gym, I think there may be some people training in here today. So in here you can see some people training from the gym. We have all the gym equipment here, kettlebells, weights, and everything that you possibly need, basically. So we'll come back out and downstairs. And I'm going to show you something really special that the Hockey Club has. And it's been here for many years, and it's something that allows us in the winter to play outdoor hockey, because in Germany it gets very cold and then you're not able to play the outdoor hockey so much. So we come out to here and we have a very large dome. Now this is called a Traglofkhalle, and what it is a dome over the pitch which we place over, so then we can play hockey inside, outside, as it were. So we train every week. We train roughly two times in the morning and three times in the evening. Sometimes we train extra, so we could end up training every day. And we also have matches two times on a weekend. We never actually play matches in the indoor hall, because the indoor hall is always put down again when it's the summertime and when the weather's not so cold. But at the moment it's very cold, so it's very important that we have this. So we're going to have a quick look inside. There are some people training at the moment, but just so you can see how it is to be inside one of these sports domes. So in here, there's some people training at the moment. You can see that there's a lot of lights. It keeps it very lit. We've got the blue pitch in here. In the summer, it's also a great pitch to play on. So yeah, that's our Traglofkhalle. So I hope that showing you a little bit around the club has given you a bit of insight into what it's like at a professional club. Now, it was really important for me to make that move because it enabled me to play more hockey. So in England, you don't get all these fancy things that you do in here in Germany. So it's actually more professional. The setup is more professional. We have trained staff, strength and conditioning coaches, physios, everything that we possibly need to have an elite lifestyle. So I hope you've enjoyed looking around with me, and goodbye.
I didn't just suddenly get to this position playing for Mannheim Hockey Club. In fact, I can honestly say that the journey to becoming an elite athlete is far from easy. And I believe that if it was, everyone would be doing it. So I'm just going to give you a little bit of background information on my journey and how it has led me to where I am today. I didn't actually begin playing hockey until I was about 9 or 10 years old because I was mainly focused on football. I was really young when I took to sports and decided quite early on when I was in school that I'd much rather be playing football with the boys in my break time than playing horses with the girls. I pushed my parents from there to let me join the local football team, and I guess this was the first experience of being in a team. It was a local boys' team, and there were not many girls playing football at that time, and it was quite unheard of actually for a girl to be playing football. I had to fight for my place in the team, and from there I began moving up levels to different clubs, which led me to playing in the girls' county team. I then played in the Chelsea development squad for a year, and then was scouted for the Reading Centre of Excellence. So here I am, just a very football mad kid around the age of 8. And when you compete in sport, you always have that worry of nerves and selection. And I really did experience this from a young age, being part of a high level setup for football, always fighting for a place and almost proving to the coaches that you're good enough for selection. I was at Ballard School in year 4 when I began playing hockey. We didn't really have the AstroTurf at the time. I think maybe it was in planning. So we played everything on grass. I joined a local hockey club, which you now probably know as of New Forest. So between Ballard and New Forest Hockey, that's where it all really began. I hadn't played hockey for that long when I was selected for the county under 14 team when I was only 10. So with this achievement, I consequently had the commitment of both hockey and football, which was double the travelling and double the time. So I moved schools to a local state school in year 7, which meant that I was no longer doing so much sport at school, but it enabled me to finish school early and have more time outside of that to do my individual sports. So the both sports actually ran very well side by side until I reached about 13, when I made a very large step up in hockey to a regional level. This meant that even though I was used to the travelling, I was going to Reading maybe 3 or 4 times a week, and then I had hockey on top of that. It became just too much. With my success in hockey, I actually decided to stop with the football, as at the age of 14, I was selected to trial for the under 16 England national hockey team. And with that, I was successful, something quite unimaginable as I was so young and up against girls that played hockey every day at school. I wouldn't like to say that I was disadvantaged not being part of a school that trained hockey every day, but it meant that I had to work extremely hard on my own. I practiced hockey skills in the garden. I focused on extra fitness every day to make sure that I kept up with everyone else's progressions. Since then, I've played for quite a few hockey clubs. I spent a lot of time playing at Trojans when I moved there first from New Forest. I then played for Reading, and then straight after playing for Reading, that's when I moved to my club Mannheim in Germany. And that's where I am today. So from that little overview, you can hopefully see how there are some very large decisions that need to be made along the pathway to becoming elite. The critical transition for me was changing from football to hockey. This decision was sort of made for me at the time due to my success in hockey and the travelling commitments, but I've had to make a lot of other decisions along the way about moving clubs, with my biggest leap being to Germany. I ultimately made that move because I wanted to become a better hockey player and, most of all, to be one of the best. I'm going to consider now what it takes to go from being young with an interest in sport to becoming that elite performer, as it's very known that not everyone makes it, as to be the person that does make it requires some very specific characteristics. Now, from my experiences that I've just explained to you, you may be able to pick out some key things that I have done to become elite, such as the sacrifice made to prioritise my development in sport over other activities. Take the travelling, for example. This meant that I didn't take part in activities with friends after school, as my time was filled with sport. It meant that I had to make sure all my homework was done well in time before it was due, so that I could fill my weekends with sport and activities. I actually went through secondary school never being able to really attend birthday parties because I was always attending my matches or going to training or doing extra fitness. But that really was the sacrifice I made because I wanted to become the best in my sport. I now have for you some very interesting insights into elite sport from athletes and coaches that I've met on my journey. So this is Clara Badia Bognar. She plays in the Spanish national team field hockey. She also plays in the Mannheim first team with me as one of my teammates. We are very lucky that today she is going to talk to you very briefly about what it takes, in her opinion, to become an elite athlete.
Hi, my name is Clara Badia Bognar. I play field hockey for the Spanish national team. For me, an elite athlete is someone who is highly disciplined and compromised, but also someone who is willing to take criticism and who works hard to improve every day.
So the key things that we can really learn from Clara's view on elite sport are that to become elite, you need to be able to accept criticism. Firstly, this means that when we are told that we must improve something, we take that on board and we look at ways to achieve that. It means that you must be willing to learn, because by believing that you are already good enough will not ever be enough. So taking on these criticisms are important to then listen and absorb every information that you are given. Clara also mentions the discipline that is required. Discipline means to have an element of self-control, to behave in a way that enables you to reach your goals. Finally, Clara mentions the hard work that is required. However, she doesn't just tell us that it is hard work that is needed. She says about working hard to improve every day, so that this is not something you can commit to 50%. You have to be committed every day to complete training and development activities so that you can improve to a level of an elite standard. If we consider the rule by Malcolm Gladwell that 10,000 hours of deliberate practice is required to master a skill, that equates to a lot of time spent dedicated to the sport, particularly those sports that have many skills. Hard work is therefore a large element of what makes an athlete become elite. I'm a very large believer that the extra 10 minutes a day dedicated to achieving something will give you the edge over someone that doesn't. If we relate this to the theory, that extra 10 minutes you will get practicing every single day, you will therefore get to that 10,000 hours of deliberate practice much quicker than if you didn't. You may recognise this very significant picture of a swimming legend called Michael Phelps. Now, he has given the quote once before, many times, which he says, "You are laying the foundation, so it's always remembering that those little small steps and those little small things can add up to massive things." So what he means by this goes back to exactly what we've just been speaking about, with it's that extra bit of time that you spend in enabling you to get to that high level of skill or to master that technique that you've been working for. And that's exactly how Michael Phelps has ended up being one of the most successful swimmers in the world, with so many credible honours and the medals that he's been able to carry around his neck. An elite athlete is someone that's really committed to learning, and with that it enables them to constantly develop. From my own experience having played with other elite athletes, I know how much can be learnt from others. There's actually a very experienced Olympic international who plays in my team, and we actually play in the same position. So I found myself really learning from her and soaking up all the information that she had given me, and most importantly, watching her play and the way that she moves across the pitch. I never really look at her as competition or someone that I'm trying to beat, because why would I need to? She's one of the best in the world, so why would I need to compete against her when I can learn from her? We can already see that to become elite, you must have a large amount of dedication and you must really focus on the task that you have to do. I have here now a clip from a very famous man in the hockey world. His name is Andreo. He is currently the coach of the men's first team at Mannheim Hockey Club. He was also a very successful hockey player himself. And he is going to talk to you today about two very important things that he believes an elite athlete has to have to be successful, or at least what every athlete has to have to become elite. So listen very carefully to what he says and just have a think when he's talking about what those two main things are and what you can do to achieve those two things.
Hello everyone, my name is Andreu. I'm currently the head coach of Mannheimer Hockey Club men's team in Germany. Previously, I was an international hockey player for Spain. I'm from Spain. And Hannah told me to highlight a couple of things about elite sport and elite athletes. And the two things I want to mention today is, first of all, there's something common in all elite athletes. It's that they have fun during practice. And this is a very important thing that sometimes we tend to forget when we are playing, when we are in competition, in training sessions, sometimes because of the stress, sometimes because of the hard work mindset, we forget that we play hockey because we like this activity, because we have fun, because we enjoy this practice. So this is the first point. You guys have to have fun in your daily basis and enjoy every second on the field with your teammates. The second point I wanted to highlight is the individual responsibility. And that's a very important thing. That's something that every time I try to remind this to my athletes, that they are the most responsible actors in their performance. So you have to take the ownership of your performance and you have to be really responsible of what you do. What does it mean? That, for example, you have to use the staff, you have to use the coaches for the sake of your performance. You have to ask questions, you need to make sure that you know what they expect from you. You know your objectives, you know your strengths, your weaknesses. You are really aware and conscious about these things. But also responsibility means that it's not only during the training session where you have to switch into athlete. Being a top athlete, it's a 24/7 thing. So it's also about the different habits like sleeping, like eating, nutrition. All of these things are very important. So you have to take the responsibility in every dimension and sphere of your life. If you do it, if you are the main responsible of your performance, then you will be anything that you achieve, it will be because of you, and you are not going to be a victim of someone else. That's very important, and that's very, very common in all top athletes. So these are the two things, have fun and be responsible, and I think you will be in the right pathway.
So hopefully you are able to pick out the two key things that Andreo has given us as tools to becoming elite athletes. Now the first thing that he mentioned was to have fun and to enjoy the process of what you're doing. So what he's trying to say here is that you have to enjoy every minute that you're on the pitch with your teammates, because the higher you go and the more elite you get, a lot of stress can take over and this can really affect your mindset. So to try and enjoy every minute and have fun while you're doing it, it then almost seems less of a chore of what you have to do. He also mentioned the individual responsibility. So everybody is responsible for their own well-being, for making sure they're at training on time, making sure you're ready, making sure you've got your kit correct, your bag packed. He also says about using the staff and the coaches so that when you don't know what to do, you feel confident to ask a question, or you ask a question about how you can improve. Because he mentions that becoming the elite athlete is 24/7. You cannot switch off from it. And it's almost similar to what Clara said, in that you have to work hard to improve every day, which means that you cannot just do it 50% or 75%. You have to do it 100%, which means committing to yourself all the time, meaning that you're sleeping correctly, eating the right things, and ultimately, your responsibility will determine your own destiny. So if you're responsible for what you're doing, you will be able to complete your goals and achieve your dreams. This individual responsibility is quite interesting for us. Within a school environment, or even a work environment, if you have that same individual responsibility that Andreu has highlighted there, that's common within elite sport, if you are able to apply that to your normal life, so maybe your homework or your maths work in class, if you are individually responsible to completing that homework on time, you are in control of that destiny, and that homework is then completed and you are responsible for that. You can submit it and you can move on. There are many factors that prevent someone from making it to the top. For example, injuries are one large factor that maybe can determine your whole career path or prevent you from ever playing your sport again. If you are able to get back from it, it means that you have overcome a very large setback. I can honestly say that sustaining an injury can be one of the hardest challenges to overcome, because sometimes you really just don't know what the future holds and how well the healing process will be. So you almost have to start from the beginning again, teaching your body how to function with that injured area. So this is me about 2 years ago. I was training in Mannheim and I sustained an injury to my left foot. And this meant that I could not play hockey for about 18 months. And I was in a boot, I was on crutches for an extremely long time. And I finally was able to get back to some normality after a few months. I came back to the UK, I did lots of training to get myself better again. And I hadn't actually planned to do any more hockey at the time. But I had just been offered a job working as a coach for a very large sports school, and a week before I start, I got a call from Mannheim asking if I would go back and play in their first team. So I was there thinking that I would be back playing with my club in the UK, or just working and seeing how hockey went. So I then changed completely back to hockey, being 100% focused on it, into this professional setup. And I really didn't know what my foot was going to do, whether I was even good enough to play back at that level after 18 months off. But what I learned from my injury is that even if you have a huge setback, if you really put your mind to it and you focus on getting better, you can find more opportunities. And it definitely was for me a completely changing my perspective on everything, and getting that opportunity to play for Mannheim was just the best thing that could ever happen to get me back into my sport again. For some of you, this might be quite a familiar face, as well known throughout British sport, but it hasn't always looked like this for Andy Murray, a trophy in his hand. In fact, Andy Murray spent a lot of his early career in second place, just missing out on the top spot. Along with that, he has overcome some career-threatening injuries. For example, in January 2019, he had hip surgery, and just 5 months after, he made a comeback winning the doubles at the Queen's Cup. This would have required an extreme amount of determination and commitment to following his rehab programs, to follow what the physios and the doctors were telling him to do, to make sure his nutrition was right, so that in 5 months he could get from being a very successful tennis player who has sustained an injury to then fight back and do exactly the same thing again. Getting to an elite level is never something that's going to be easy for anyone. So one of the largest things an athlete has to overcome is the setback of deselection. Getting dropped from a team or missing out on a medal position may give them the feeling that they should give up or that they just can't do it anymore. But they have this inner drive to then prove their worth for the next assessment where they've maybe worked on their improvement recommendations. I do believe that if every athlete gave up because of one result or one person told them that they're not good enough, then there wouldn't be many elite athletes out there. If we use football, for example, Luke Shaw was 8 years old when Chelsea didn't offer him a place at their academy. He then went on to develop at Southampton, becoming now a player at Man United since 2014. A similar occurrence was for Harry Kane, who got released from the Arsenal Academy aged 8. These are both extremely well-known athletes that would have required large amounts of motivation to get back on their feet and continue playing the sport to reach the level that they are now. The opportunity and the access to elite sport can be very much influenced by what family you are born into. So, for example, your socioeconomic background and the extent to which your family can support you. I believe there are many athletes that are young and unable to get to their trainings due to costs or available time within their family. As if you think about it, if you're 8 and you've got to travel to all these far destinations, it's not really possible to get the train alone and make these commitments. So parental support is an extremely important factor in getting to that elite level. For example, if my parents were not committed to driving me to training to London for my football, I may never have had the opportunity to develop to the level that I am at now. When an athlete is stood on the podium, we tend to just consider their achievement and what talent they must have to get there. But their past almost always will stem from a far deeper situation than what we see when they stand and receive their medal. I am going to show you now just a short video of some unique moments from the Rio 2016 Olympics, and I would like you to just have a think about the emotions here along the way, what they really mean, and whether seeing this makes you think differently about their achievements and what you might think when they're stood on the podium receiving their medal.
And the tears are starting to come now.
Michael Phelps, this certainly, he says, is his farewell.
Tears flowing on both sides.
Delpo the Destroyer, punishing tennis.
Wonderful moment for Ruslan Narutov. Glory for Uzbekistan.
Leaving his shoes there, he's retired.
Olympic champion in your home country, doesn't get much better than that.
What a moment for a country that has felt so much pain and has overwhelmed both captain and coach.
Andy Murray has done it again.
Gwen Jorgensen, all the hard work has paid off, and look at the emotion.
I don't think Kurokaki can quite believe it.
So this video presents a whole stream of emotions from those completing those races, those medal-winning moments to those reaching retirement, all have really one thing in common, and that's their tears displayed through their emotion. But we must question, actually, what do those tears really mean? Well, they could represent the achievement of winning that medal or completing that race, the challenge, the feeling of success, or do they feel maybe strongly about overcoming self-doubt, or even the sadness that they may have just missed out on a medal position, or the anger about that one mistake that's cost them the whole competition. Each individual works every living hour to achieve their goal, and perhaps qualifying for an Olympics is their lifelong dream. So there is no doubt that when they are there at the top of their game, their emotions are running extremely high the whole time. Let's consider the retiring athlete in this clip. So he leaves his shoes on the platform. Sport is most likely his identity, so to suddenly decide that this is his last event would have been a far from easy decision. Here, his emotions would represent the joy of competing in the sport that he's worked his life for, but perhaps also the sadness of leaving the sport. Maybe he has a concern for what he has ahead of him without the competition. This brings me on to the next section of, is it all really worth it? Are the sacrifices that you make to become elite really worth the rewards that you get? Certainly, if you do make it big in sport to an elite level, you can have a great life and live doing what you love doing. So I'm going to show you here a few pictures. Some of them might be very familiar to you, and others may be not so familiar, yet they all have one thing in common. They are gold medalists. As someone looking at these athletes, we may think about how driven they may be winning that medal, the glory or the fame. But those that don't achieve it make us question what the desire really is and whether it's all worth it. Because we've already seen that you have to make a lot of sacrifices to get there. And it's a very emotional journey to get to the pinnacle of being the best of the best. Is it really their need to win medals and become famous? Because at the end of the day, a new set of athletes come onto the stage, and then we no longer remember those that were in a particular Olympics or a particular World Cup. So if we consider all these athletes that don't quite make it, and knowing that the fame and the prize money doesn't last forever, there must be another drive that gets an athlete out of bed early in the morning to train, to eat the right things and be 100% dedicated. Because not all of these athletes live the high life that we imagine of those professional footballers and top tennis players, as some sports do not have such funding. More often than not, an athlete requires an intrinsic motivation, which gives them that feeling of winning and succeeding, seeing that their hard work pays off, and gaining satisfaction from the journey. From the emotional video that we previously saw of the athletes crying, it is evident that there is far more to competing than we may think, purely by their release of emotion. As we know, not everyone makes it. Some people may be at many Olympics and never win a medal, or never get recognised. Their intrinsic reward and indicator of success may be the achievement of a personal best, or the pride of reaching that level and the chance of competing on the world stage. Some may feel the satisfaction of seeing others achieve. What I'm trying to point out here is that success is different for everyone. So that gold medal around one person's neck is reflective of their hard work, not an achievement from one race or one competition. On the other hand, achieving gold for one person may be completely different. It might not be in the form of a medal around the neck, meaning that their success may mean something quite different, but equally, everyone has achieved their personal goals, feeling similar satisfaction. For example, some of you may be sat there thinking, well, elite sport, nah, it's got nothing to do with me, I'm not going to be an Olympian winning gold medals, which is absolutely fine, but what we can understand is that gold for one person may be different for another. So have a little think about maybe what gold is for you, because it may not be in the form of a medal or a sporting an achievement. It could be passing a test with a certain grade, achieving your dream job, handing in your homework on time, Whatever gold is for you, if you are prepared to make the same sacrifices as an Olympic athlete or an elite athlete, you are able to then achieve your Olympic medal and gold, whatever that might be for you. There may be highs and lows of any career pathway. When it's all going well, it's fun, the results come easily, the athlete is motivated and committed to the goals. But within one moment, this motivation can all change. Consider all the bad training sessions that an athlete may experience, or the times when things just quite didn't go their way. All these moments are what makes the athlete reach the top of their sport, as these moments do not make them quit. However hard it is to continue after a setback, a bad result, or even just not feeling quite up to it, they continue to push themselves hard to overcome the next barrier. Ultimately, the quicker that they can recover from a bad training session and almost put it behind them, the quicker that they can continue working on their goals again. Think about this. How many times have you had PE lesson? You've just got out of bed and seen the rain out the window, and in that moment you think to yourself, oh no, it's PE today. And you convince a parent to write an excuse note, or you suddenly don't feel very well in that geography lesson conveniently placed before PE. Every human has the same emotions, as I can assure you. I don't wake up every morning and think, oh yay, great, it's training today. Or, great, I've got a gym session. To become elite, an athlete will suffer that session even if they don't feel up to it. Because at the end of the day, if they didn't, their opponent has the chance to get ahead. Ultimately, if these sessions that make the athlete reach the level that they want to achieve. For the older among you, consider the times you have planned to go to the gym but not quite made it because that one extra email prevented you from going when really it took only 10 minutes. It is so easy to avoid putting in the hard work. But to be the best, that is exactly what is required. And this all boils down to an element of mental toughness, the fight to keep going even when the times are tough or when you don't want to do something, the inner drive to wanting to succeed. Mental toughness is a common theme among elite sport. If we think back for a moment to Michael Phelps, as the most successful swimmer in history, there's so much that we can learn from him. When asked what separates good athletes from the best, his response that it is all down to mental toughness, highlighting that if you want something so bad, you will make all the sacrifices needed to get there, and that is not because you have to, but because you want to. It can sometimes be difficult to achieve this mental toughness if you think, for example, of all the challenges that have been presented of competing in elite sport and becoming an elite sportsperson. So it may not be easy, but as elite athletes, there are things that we can do to make it easier to become at a peak of mental toughness. One psychological strategy that is used very often in elite sport is visualization. The belief with this is that once you can visualize yourself doing something, when you actually do that movement, it becomes very much already familiar to you. So somehow you convince your brain that you can do something. It can also then remove the doubt that you may have about doing something or increase the confidence you have for a particular situation or task.
You use the same part of your brain to visualize an action as when performing it for real. So the night before every match, get yourself game ready by mentally rehearsing scenarios you're likely to face. Start by visualizing the pitch, the ground you'll be playing in, when the game is, day or night, the weather, the opposition. Now imagine your team is on the break, the time you run. Control the ball perfectly. But when you visualize, don't watch yourself. See it through your own eyes. decide how to beat the keeper, feel a clean connection through the ball, and hear the crowd erupt around you. When you visualize, you're training your brain for when the time comes.
Visualization can almost be done anywhere, sitting down, at the pitch, in the changing rooms. It involves imagining yourself in a particular environment, enabling the same neural pathways to be activated during the visualization to when you're in the real environment. So when you're on the pitch, for example, you can then recreate a pass that you've been visualizing or the goal that you've imagined yourself scoring. I, for example, have used this gaining confidence with particular skills. So during a training session, I occasionally would come up against a drill that I was uncertain about, which led me to feel a lot of self-doubt and nerves. And for anyone that has felt nervousness, you would understand how this can really negatively affect your ability to be able to do something you really need to do or you want to do. So this was quite a problem for me. I was able to overcome this with visualization by standing back at the group, watching the drill, and then visualizing myself how I was going to do that drill exactly. And directly after that, I was no more worrying about what the drill involved. I then felt just more prepared to complete the task. So I was then able to step forward when it was my turn on the drill, and as if it was not my first time doing it, because I had already imagined in my mind that I had already done it one time before. I have here now some examples of elite athletes that have used visualization, and with this you'll be able to see how it can be done anywhere and you can really adapt it to what you want it to do for you. So Wayne Rooney said that, "I lie in bed the night before the game and visualize myself scoring goals or doing well." You're trying to put yourself in that moment and trying to prepare yourself to have a memory before the game. I don't know if you'd call it visualizing or dreaming, but I've always done it my whole life. So what this does for Wayne Rooney is allows him to focus on what he has to do in the game or in his next training session or anything that he can put his mind to. And it enables him to step on the pitch with that air of confidence that he already has won the game before he's got there. Michael Jordan gives us another example of how visualization can be used within training and practice. So he quotes, "Every time I feel tired while exercising and training, I close my eyes to see that picture, to see that list with my name. This usually motivates me to work again." So what he's saying here is that when times are tough and training is very difficult or he's feeling tired, he pictures the result of the hard work that he's going to get, of getting his name on the list, so being selected for the match. And that enables him to then get back on and feel motivated to work hard again to make sure that his name is on the team list. When you next have a meeting, a presentation, or a sporting event like a match, or even training, you can now have a think about how you may use visualization to help you prepare for that particular event. Hopefully this presentation has given you a bit of an introduction into elite sport. Of course, from this we can see that there are challenges and struggles, but that is the same as if you want to be the best in anything. Ultimately, that is why some people make it and some people don't. Although there are many challenges, it can bring so many positives. You can really learn so much and you gain a lot along the way. I, for example, have made great friends from all over the world and had a lot of achievements to go with it. My advice to anyone that wants to compete in elite sport is to go for it and be prepared to make sacrifices along the way, but also be prepared to enjoy the journey and have the most amazing time. Because for me, elite sport has opened so many doors and allowed me to be in the position that I am today.
So I hope that you've enjoyed listening with me today and exploring all about elite sport. Now, if there's one bit of advice I can give you, and that is whether your dream is within sports or something maybe not sports related at all, find what gold is for you. And once you've found what that goal is, that is maybe going to become your dream. And if you work hard to achieve that, you have great commitment and you're prepared to make sacrifices, I believe that anyone can reach those goals. So, if you listen to the principles that you've learned today all throughout the presentation on Elite Sport, I truly believe find your dream, set your goals, and you can achieve anything you want to achieve. Thank you very much for listening and joining me today, and good luck with everything that you want to achieve.